Thank you. First of all, the first thing I'd like to tell you is get a haircut. You should have come with me this afternoon. I got very good haircut. Very good. I can show you. It's on York. So it doesn't cost much. It's not like Korea. It's much more, much cheaper. You like to play this piece?
Yeah.
Have you played it before in public?
Yes.
With orchestra?
No.
No. Where? In piano?
It's just piano.
Where? In Korea?
No, in
Manhattan.
Where is that? Manhattan? You mean it's a school? Aha. So in public meaning with a piano, where in class?
It's Jewish, yeah.
Jewish, yeah. Not public concert.
Mm-hmm.
Aha, okay. So you'd like to play in a public concert?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You will?
Yes.
But not tomorrow. Okay. You're doing so much better. He's been with us only less than a year, right? You came last September,
mm-hmm.
And we've had an up, and we've had a bit of a down. And now he's coming back up again. I won't bore you with details. But that's kind of what happens with some of the players, some of the students that come to us that start to work very seriously about concept. Concept of music, concept of sound, concept of appearance, concept of many, many things. And essentially, and I'm telling this not to the kids that have been here already for 10 days, but the people that have, that don't come here to study, they're just here to visit tonight or tomorrow, whatever you do. There are two sides of the brain. Some doctors believe it's the front and the back, some believe it's a mishmash. It's all of it. I like to call it back, I like to call it right and left, because the left controls the right and the right controls the left. I call the right side the bank account, because if you play well with a nice sound, musically speaking, you'll get more money. I can vouch for that. But seriously speaking, you can continue your journey for a very, very long time if you really go back every day to the fundamentals of creating the sound. And the bow is 85% of what we do. If you didn't have the bow, your name is Segovia. It doesn't mean that pizzicatos are not important. Very important. How do you play pizzicatos, forte, piano, up here, blah, blah, blah. There's lots of things one can do with pizzicatos. You can do thumb, you can go this way, this way, this way, all kinds of different ways. So pizzicato is important, but not that important. This is important. So we start really with a fundamental aspect, which is, we call it catch the string and release it at the same time. So we catch the string, catch and release. What's ironic is that when we pluck the string vibrates this way. And when we put the bow down, it stops the sound. Hence, we call it catch release. And I do that in every country, doesn't matter what it is, it's in English. I don't know how to say catch release in any other language. Can you say it in Korean? No. So we have a translator, usually, or hopefully 99% of the time, is somebody that has studied the violin. Because if I get a scientist, they don't know what the hell I'm talking about. They say, catch, what are you catching? I said, well, flies, you know. So, very important. That's terminology that we start, and you never leave it. If you leave that for one day, you're dead in the water. And there's so many things that we do in order to make that work. In order to make that work, we need to bend the thumb and curl the fingers on the bow. And it has to be at a particular angle, i.e. a plane, which is this. This is number two. This is number one. This is number two. This is number three. This is number four. Are you with me?
Yeah.
It's not an area code. Okay, so one, two, three, four, four, three, two, one. So that elbow is constantly working together in concert with the fingers and the thumb. Very difficult, not easy. He's done very well. He already has a very wonderful basic sound and a connection to the music. But in order to make it even more part of his whole terminology, his vocabulary in music, we need to really work on that ball even more, which we are doing. And in a year from now, he will be a much better player because he'll be happier with the sound he's making, okay? He wasn't very happy in the beginning, but he came to the lessons and I would start playing and he would go, are you ready? So that's okay, you gotta be impressed by something, you know? So, but I told him, he's gonna do the same thing. Now he's beginning, now he doesn't do that anymore because he understands the concept. All right, so that's the basic rule and I always start the class with that wherever we are. Doesn't matter where it is. So, what do we do in the beginning? What is the first three notes? What do you call that, those first three notes, in musical terms, in harmony? Harmony, harmonically speaking, what is the first three notes? You can say it in Korean if you want. What are the first three notes? What is it called? Mozart, A major.
A-C-E.
Yeah, but what is it called? What?
A major chord.
Hey, bravo. So which is the most important note in that chord?
Sorry?
Which is the most important note that you should express in the beginning of that? Huh?
E.
E. Why? As you can see, it's the first time we're covering this act. Because it's the weakest note. It's the fifth of the chord. This is strong. Weaker. And that's why we make a small crescendo. It's not really a crescendo, it's just support. Don't force. Okay, basically even, but you have to know that that's the weakest chord, weakest note of the chord, right? Now, when you start the allegro, what happens in the allegro, the first bar? It's the same thing, right? But Mr. Mozart is smart. He goes, he has an eighth note, which is part of the chord. Okay, but there's no blah, it's so. Good. You like that, no?
Yeah.
So those little elements of musical aspects are very important. And you're doing it very well because now you're really using your bow properly. Okay? All right. So now when you do, for example, you made a diminuendo. That's makeup. It's stronger. You have a seventh. Now here you have to join. Then you have to dee da da dee da da. You have to go to 30 seconds already. You understand? So do it again. Oh, start again. Two, three, four. Thank you. very good. That's all very good. Don't make too many stops, though.
Mm.
It's just a little bit too effective now.
Mm.
The suspension you want, keep it suspensive. You know, don't go ta. And we lost it. Okay.
Mm.
Good. That's pretty good. So from here. Thank you. sounds good the first time, do the second time the same thing. Why make life difficult, you know? He didn't write that anyway. Okay, so you have to guide the sound. Don't make all of a sudden things that he didn't put in there. Okay, Tira Tega, second time, Tira Tega. Don't be afraid to use that. Do it a little bit slower. No. Not clean.
the stream crossings, I have to change with the arm to each different level.
Okay. You understand that? We were talking about that before. Remember I told you? Okay. That's good. That's terminology. Good idea. So, but catch the first note. Right? Ooh. Especially with this guy, okay? Because he goes 3 against 2, 4 against 3, 5 against 4. So if you don't do the third bar, you're gonna be dead in the water before you start. See?
Yes.
So now we have to use the bow for that. So start down, just start alone. Just practice that. Listen, I had people I knew way back when I was studying, they practice that about 25 times in 1.5 hour. And I'm not kidding. And some of it in rhythms, you know, things like that. Eventually, it's okay. But think of the music. You can do that if you want. I know you probably will. It's all good. Do that, do that. It's logical. But you're not going to the third bar. Dynamically to the third bar.
Thank you.
three against two. That's two against three now. Okay?
Yes.
Do once more. Start here. Why are you starting here? Need more bow. Inside the piano. Thing to do. Try not to do it because it loses all the tension and the architecture of the piece. When he wants you to make a retard, believe me, he's going to put RAT in there or un poco ritardando or something. Or there'll be a fermata coming, then you prepare that fermata because there's usually about two-thirds down the movement. All these great guys did that for us, great architects, you know?
Yeah.
That's very important. So try to remember that. It's an interpretation, if you like, but it's what's right, what's
yeah.
written and what's right. Not easy to do, not easy to do. You have to start really thinking that way, all right? But it's pretty good. Within a week, that's awfully nice. Thank you very much. Bravo. musically correct as far as color goes. I don't think you need to do it, but you can't. But singers don't do that. They can't. They wish they could, but they can't. Okay, they don't have a bow. They have a tessitura. So if you go okay? Change your feet position. You can't do that. Palm, just go on your left foot when you play that F sharp. Big one. No, the big one, the accent. No, way before.
Thank you.
You don't want that. Eat all out clean with a bow. The bow has to stop a little bit. Eat all out. Connect a little better. You hear that? That's you're playing a four stroke, it's not written. You're playing a little note before the A.
Yeah.
Hence you should play a different slide, which we've talked about for a minute. Imagine where he's come from G major to C minor. That's very important because you're kind of thinking the same. That's the beginning of a developing section. We need to know that. He didn't write it, but it's there. Okay? So when you start and play one here, not three. And you're there. Do that once. Nice and warm. They thought we were smart too, but we're not that smart. But we're getting better. We're getting better. Okay? And he does it a lot in many things. He did it here. He brings it there. You know? So we have to go to that one to see how that will sound, how that feels, what's the dynamic. He actually wrote slightly different language. And then the beginning is actually much easier to play. Most of us go. We start this thing, you know? It's unbelievable, right? Okay, so we have to get over that stigma. Well, how do we do it? You know how we do it? With knowledge. Knowledge is curiosity. You go curiosity, let me see what happens later, okay? That's the same thing here. Now that's good, I like that sound, okay? So do that again now.
Thank you.
It's a little later. Not that much later. Play one, play one. 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 One, 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 one. I knew her. She was a great, great lady, fantastic pianist, great composer. She helped him a lot, you know. Confident. That's good. Espressivo. That was nice espressivo. Good. She's standing on the front of the bar. So this is...
Change the color.
And if you just concentrate, it'll go way out there. You don't have to play loud, okay? This, you know, when you go... just 1.5 bars to remind us that the theme is coming back. Smart son of a gun. You know, so you... Oh! You understand? That's like a painting. All of a sudden there's a little lake in there. And all of a sudden we'll come back and we'll go swimming in the lake in a minute, like we did in the beginning. You okay? It's a stupid metaphor, but what the hell? I'll do anything to play different. Do it once more. Thank you. about, we know it already. But it's okay, we have to organize that. But that's the idea. The suspense of this is extraordinary. And he really gives us the feeling that it's coming back. It's written like that. It's really quite wonderful. So we have to slow it down quite a bit for us to understand that, for the listener. Okay? Not to be afraid of it. That's a wonderful expression. You know, you have such a beautiful sound. You really have a gorgeous sound. We need to work on a few little details, which will help you with many, 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 many things. Sliding is one of the problems. Okay? I guess you never did that, or did you? No, not really. The other one is when you shift from here. I hear a kind of a, I don't know what that is exactly. It's a kind of a hiccup almost.
Not releasing fast enough.
So we need to work on it so it goes in your ear, you know? Because otherwise it's very good. Sometimes you are here a little bit, trying to improve it by going back again. We all do that. We need to all go back. And sometimes your head is over there, which is wonderful if you're playing something like. But I want you to know, and I want to know, that you really love what you're doing. Then it's okay. You can go to sleep. Because you're really inside the sound. But only few instances. Don't do too much of that. But for now, I will definitely look at it. And you stop looking up. When you first started a week and a half ago, you were looking up. I don't know where the hell you're going. But that's part of concentration for a lot of people. But you can concentrate with your eyes here. You don't need to go up there. Okay? I've seen that. Boys do a lot of that. Why? I don't know. I guess the mirror is very high. Oh, look at my hair. Yeah, boys, I've seen a lot of boys. It's actually a problem, it's a concentration problem, which we're not going into tonight, okay? But you can fix that also, yeah. What else would you like to do right now that will make you feel good?
I don't know.
You don't know? Well, in that case, thank you very much. Start with the left foot.
Right.
When you play, ostensibly you start on the left cheek. You don't start on the right cheek on the A string. Look, you have to. I suppose in concept you should start together, but you know some people go. You use the knees a lot. Piatigorsky used the knees so much. Lenny Rose, we all do that. All great cellists use their knees. They don't just sit there. Like a telephone pole, or two telephone poles. You have to move it because it releases the sound of the cello. And then you have to go forward sometimes, sometimes you go backwards. You can't do this. There, it's all YouTube with the head. That's no good. But it throws everything off center, okay? So you shift the weight and you shift the bow. We do it the other way, that's all. We go almost the same, but not quite. You understand? So when you go, you go a dumbo, you just go out. I don't go. Very few times I will go out to the right foot when I'm playing really loud. Whoa. sometimes, very few times, I'm talking about a handful, you know, 150 pieces, when it's loud. When it's soft, you don't. You just, also, if you're here, the string length is not so long. If you're not here, if you're here, the string is so long. I mean, I'm talking long. So you want to bring it back to you. You don't want to go the other way. So if you're going to the right, you're going away from the violin, see? You want to go to the left here. Oh, that feels so good. Now, yes, you shift, absolutely. But you have to shift properly. If you shift too soon, the bow is going to go. The left hand is going to go. So it's all in combination. Take some time to work on it. I would say, I don't know, maybe 6 to 2 months, 6 weeks to 2 months, if you play a lot, if you put a lot of rosin, it dries up the hair. So essentially, what's going to happen is they're going to break. Eventually they dry up, the hair dries up, you know? So we use, you go to the barber, you know how they use all that stuff on your hair? We just use rosin. So it's in order to make the hair live longer in the barber shop, right? I don't use any. But you just make sure you brush it properly. You don't go, ah. If you go, ah, it's going to break. Eventually, it's going to break because it dries out. So you go and change it. $75. And they do. What? $75? Now what are you going to do? Then don't play. Yeah.
So I was wondering how come the older style.
Can you stand up?
Give me an example. So
like,
fix
yeah,
up.
Like yours.
I'm not going to go there. Give me another example.
Perlman.
Well, who else?
Heitzitz.
That was not thick. That was gold. I heard it live. Partly because of the way he distributed the gold. He never actually played, he did. He also had a gut string, which has a totally different overtone than these things, these parallel things. And those guys played the venue. They played the instrument inside the venue. They did not play the instrument inside the Bose speakers, okay? That's very misleading. When this music that we play today was written, this didn't exist, neither did the lights. So you have to compromise, and you have to learn how to go within a particular style, if you like. Style is the wrong, terrible, terrible word, but it's to make sure that you play your five dynamics. You have to go back, forget that, those speakers and microphones. You gotta go pianissimo, we have five dynamics. Pianissimo, piano, mezzo forte, forte, and fortissimo. Four pianos is a color. Three pianos is a, I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to play four pianos. Okay? But if I'm coming from pianissimo, which is a color, I'll try to create another color. Okay, so composers put Mahler, Wagner, all these guys, they put down different dynamics beyond what we know is the basic five dynamics. Okay? and you have to judge it. You have to judge what it is that you want to produce when you see the written page. Sometimes we play too loud because there is a very large venue. These pieces were not written for 2,000, 2,500 seats auditorium. Today, Toyota will give you an analysis on the computer. My steak gets stuck in my throat. I don't know what the hell he's talking about. 103 plus this and the other, and it's a percentage of such and such, but it's all in Japanese, so I really don't understand what he's saying. And then you look, but he makes good holes that produce a sound that goes out. What I want is the sound to come back. I want to hear that coming back to me, because it takes about a good 5 seconds before that disappears. So I already want to hear that coming back to me. Do you understand? Therefore, I can now judge how much and how little. When I go on venues, I don't play loud. I actually just tune very quietly without anybody there. I just judge it. I listen. And then I'll do a little more. See how it comes back. And kind of within 5 minutes, I kind of know what I have to do. It embraces you rather than you going boom. It's unnecessary. This goes boom. And then if you don't hear it, you put your earphones on and you put even more of the button. Mistake. Okay? But you have to learn where the weight of the bow. This is very heavy weight. This is very light. You want to make it sound the same, right? That's where your fingers and your whole aspect of how you achieve that begins to really sound healthy. Sometimes you play a little deeper, some you play a little softer. Vibrato has a lot to do with it. You don't want to go because there's nothing that goes out. Okay, it's a release, like this. See? So, all right? Confusing, right? It's all right, just practice. Keep listening.
I'm interested in...
Wait, there's somebody here. I try not to do that, actually. Try to make it as even as possible. Sometimes it doesn't work. So, but I start the note thinking of the A natural. I don't just go back.
Yes.
It's much easier because I'm playing. So sometimes it's a little wider. It's harmony. It's not so bad. As long as it doesn't go out of tune. Okay? But speed of bow is very important.
That gentleman.
I was interested in the physicality of playing. In the NEC orchestra, the principal violinist seems to be a very physical player. Is that physicality assisting him in technique, or is it really a matter of emotion?
You have to ask him that question. I like people to move when they play. I don't like this idea that if somebody moves in a section, somebody goes, don't move. What does that mean, don't move? So I'll go home, you know? The question is how much and what you want to do and how you lead and how you stop the ball and what you do in order to make sure that it doesn't disturb. But I mean, you see the Berlin Philharmonic people, they're all moving. That's great. That means they're really involved in the aspect of producing the right quality and the phrasing of what's written in front of them. If you don't move, you're dead in the water. You're going to have so much pain. Stiff is no good. I mean, we are told in America, don't move. Well, move if you want. There is movement. Oboe players, for example, in Europe, they'll well, maybe it helps the diaphragm. You know, each one's a little bit different. It's okay. It's okay. Moving is good. The right way to move, I think, is the right thing to do.
And he's so, if you talk about the leader, he's leading a whole section behind. If he's going to be sitting there just sleep, how is that whole section going to follow?
His movement is it's extraordinary.
Yeah. That's why he's here. No secret, first of all. Stop with the secrets. Joey was unique in the seat. So was Gingo. Totally different, but unique. Both were extraordinary. When Joey wanted something, if he wanted the orchestra to follow, not just the section, first of all, he played just about everything from memory. Okay? I mean, he really did. He had the most amazing memory. And he loved that music to death, which you saw when he played. You certainly heard it. He was a fabulous, physically, he was so easy. So let's say he's here, the conductor's there. If he wanted attention, that's all he did. He went like this. Oh, hello. He didn't go. You know? You wait for the beat and you go, ah, hello. Okay, you understand?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you see a wrong beat, let's say in Beethoven fifth, which you usually do, you better leave that. That came from the bow. That's all. Just a little bit. Everybody's right there. Look, they're all there, see? It's amazing. You don't have to move that much. When you want expression, yeah, sometimes you go this way, in the chair, in the first chair, sometimes. But that's just my way. And I, by the way, I've never led an orchestra, so I'm just guessing. Okay. But one of the most impressive aspects is when an orchestra starts really together for all the different elements that are in the band. Okay, it's kind of amazing. Some of it has to do with the concept of the actual sound itself of what the orchestra can produce. And you experiment. Down bow, up bow, in the middle, not in the middle. The biggest problem is the string section because it's 2/3 of the orchestra. It's the biggest section. The winds, they're soloists, meaning in the best sense of that, they will take care of their intonation, their articulation. They will talk to each other, you know? That's fine, no problem. And if it comes back the wrong way, I say, excuse me, what the hell were you saying there? Could you just tell me what you said? So they say that and go, oh yeah, okay, maybe we'll try this instead of that. And they go, okay, let's try that. You know what I mean? But it's very fast. In the strings, there's a whole bunch of different elements. It's how you want the sound to come out in the string section. There was a wonderful BBC tape after the war with Jochum. Jochum is a great conductor. And the BBC announcer asked him, he said, Maestro, how do you make the sound so vibrant in the orchestra? And Jochum said, the orchestra must be vroom, not boom. So you hear the chord, you heard. You never heard. No. So you can talk about that forever. If it sounds good, it sounds good. There will be some discussion, should we play the one single note on the top, on the bottom, that's where we rehearse. And it goes on like that. You know, if you heard, I walk right out. Okay? Because that's unnatural. And it's also short. It's too short. Two.
Back to the violin, my violin technique is weaker, and I was wondering if
shouldn't be that way. It's what it's how you approach the viola technique. I'm not observing what you're saying, and it's very subjective. What is it that you're working on the viola technique that you're trying to fix, and then go to the violin?
Well, for example, if I'm playing scales like in octaves, thirds, sixths, and I on viola, and then if I'm working on this for many days, and then I go back to the violin and I haven't played violin in like a week, and I play scales on violin, the same octave, sixth, thirds, it takes me a lot more time to get used to it, as opposed to the other way around.
That's good, that's right, that's true. I always try to play the viola after the fiddle in the same recital, because it's bigger. When you go from bigger to smaller, but you can learn and memorize that feeling.
The feeling's in your hands.
Mm-hmm. And if you're not playing it for, let's say, 6 days, take a little time before you start playing and say, what is this instrument I just picked up? You know, because it's a bit here, but it's a lot here. Because the viola is here and the fiddle is here. So everything gets a little bit gemushed, you know? But don't do it. Just remember where that is. It'll come back in 20 seconds. If you memorize it.
So many things, it depends on also the size of your viola, the size of the neck of the viola compared to the size of the neck of your violin. I mean, there's just really a lot of variable. But if your neck of the viola is not too thick, the third should not feel so different.
It's actually quite thick, that's probably.
There's your answer.
Yeah.
Also, it's heavier, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because of that. Well, fix it. One more question. Yes.
Back to the physical aspect of playing, but now speaking more as a performer than as just a violinist. When you're performing in front of an audience, like in front of an orchestra or in a solo recital with piano, do you actively think of ways to engage with the audience, like when it comes to moving?
Well, I go out there and I say, $5 from you, $10. You know, Elman used to do that. He said, oh, maybe only $500 tonight. No, I don't. No, I don't do any of that stuff. I don't make a parade out of anything. It's hard enough to go out there and play properly. You work and you think and you discipline your whole aspect of being a musician, being the best player you know how. If I start thinking about Mrs. Schwartz and Mr. Smith, and did they eat well, did they not eat well, did they have a martini or maybe two martinis, I don't know, I don't care. I play. And I play the same way in Oklahoma, Tallahassee, Amarillo, or Berlin. Exactly the same way. You stop playing down to an audience because you think they're not smart enough or cultured enough, ooh, you're dead in the water in 20 minutes. So don't do that. Don't think of the audience. Bring the audience to you. If you can, there are ways of doing that very subtly. You can come out and you can look. I usually look at the exit sign because I want to get the hell out of there. So I look and I bow, right? They're all clapping, clutching, blah, blah, blah. I turn around, already tuned, by the way, backstage. I don't start tuning on stage because it doesn't say so in the score. I've heard the A 100 million times. You know, orchestras play an A. They play 3-4 A's before a concert. So I know that A, so I tune it. And when I play a concerto, I usually do it, if they're trumpets, I tune to the trumpet, because that's the real, I usually do that. I hear that sometimes the D's and the C's of the timpani. I do a lot of that, knowing the orchestra, of course. So I don't waste any time, I'm ready. And so I wait. If there's a tutti of 3.5 minutes, I just wait. And they always look at me like, are you ready? What the hell do you think I'm doing? So the next night, if there's a second night, I said, please don't look at me, just start. Don't worry, I have 3.5 minutes, I'll be okay. No, I'm serious. This is very serious business. Because now you've lost the attention of the audience. OK? okay? Because now the conductor goes, okay, what's the tempo here? Let me see. Are you ready? Yeah, I'm ready. Okay, what's the tempo? Oy, 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 oy. You understand? These are all aspects. Visual is important, but it's not theater. It's for making that page sound really good. Pages, I should say. Okay? And sometimes I will play with the tutti's because I like to play with the orchestra. It's a good feeling. It also warms me up. So these are all aspects that you learn along the way when you play 55 years, as I have. I'll tell you a story, and then we'll stop. Isaac Stern asked me to come to his place in Connecticut many years ago. I was learning the Beethoven concerto. I was about 16. So I spent about 2 weeks with him, and every morning we got up and we went to the studio, and we started the Beethoven violin concerto. We played until the tutti, 4 days. 4 days, that's all. He drove me out of my mind, you know. Don't play octaves, play connection. Now come. Etc. Etc. Tempo. All that. I mean, it was amazing. And then after we finished the whole thing, he said, "Now, when you're gonna go play it, and let it be. Start playing it. Let it be. Because by that time, you have been there for about almost 3 minutes, and just go." Then play three A's while they play chords. And then get ready. Good advice, right? Same thing next time. That's what he did all his life, you know? Again, three. Okay. Well, I play the concerto. Sometimes so-so, sometimes a little better, blah, 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 blah. Guess what? He dies. I go to play the thing about a month later, and I go, "I am not going to do what he said." He's not coming. He's not going to hear it. And you know what? It made absolutely no difference. Because I was so tuned in to playing it, the next night, guess what I did? Is that crazy or what? I still do it. Good night, guys. Good night.